Okay.
Thanks, guys. You're always so quick to let us know how bad we're feeling.
All right. I'm not, and I'm just hearing good things in chat, not bad things. Yes, you couldn't laugh at the joke because we were muted the whole time. All right, let's just do an introduction. Hi, yes. Everyone. Welcome to Awesome Hardware. This is a live show. I do it with Kyle, my good friend here, every Tuesday evening at 5:30 p.m. Pacific time.
Usually.
We stream to twitch.tv/awesomehardware if you're watching us live on Twitch. We're also streaming live to YouTube right now as well, so we're double streaming because we're fancy like that. So I hope everyone can see us and hear us. Because when well, it sounds okay.
We got a new soundboard.
Because we got a new
from Monoprice. Yeah. Thank you, Steve, for hooking us up there. But this is the first time we've ever used it, and we had absolutely no time to actually test it beforehand. Yeah. So
literally 8 minutes before the show, we were like, audio.
Yeah.
Crap. And
So you guys are our guinea pigs. You guys are our test right now. So let us know how we're coming through.
That's how it turned out, though. But people are saying that sound is good, so fabulous. Thank you guys all for joining us. Thanks, all for being in chat and providing a bit of moderation in there. We have tons of stuff to talk about.
We do.
I do not have the show up as far as things over here yet.
Thanks. I opened up all the links.
Kyle did. Oh, thank you, Kyle. Never
You're
mind.
Welcome.
See? We're on top of things.
Scrape it together at the last minute.
All right, so let's start off with some good news, which is that you guys can win some stuff.
Yes, you can.
Right now. We both have giveaways going on. Of graphics cards. Kyle's giving away an R9 390X.
I don't know why I decided to pause it right on that frame.
Kyle there giving his O face with the like, ew.
Ew.
The O face.
Ew, you know you like this. Ew.
So there's a link right there. It's on Kyle's channel, Awesome Sauce Network. I am also giving away a graphics card and a GTX 980. So yeah, guys, you should enter those. The links are in the descriptions on each of those individual videos.
Yep.
And we wish you all the best of luck. It's just both of our ways of saying a thank you to those of you who have subscribed to us over the years.
When my giveaway ends on the 15th of this month. When does yours end?
I think the 17th.
Okay.
They're both within a couple days.
So you guys have about a week left to enter.
Yeah.
But
so there's still
suggest you do it now.
Still a little bit of time left. And, if the audio is out of sync, that is one thing that we have nothing, there's nothing we can do about that.
Right.
It's as is on YouTube, it's as is on Twitch. We can't fix it in post.
Right.
We'll fix it for future episodes. We'll leave it at that.
Some things you can't fix in post, guys.
Right.
Accept that. It's part of growing up.
Although, once you get used to the being able to fix things in post, it's like you really wish you could do it all the time.
I know.
All right.
That's true.
We have ongoing requests out for Awesome Hardware logos. We are enhancing the logo for this little show that we do. We already have a good amount of entries to us, but if you guys still have some that you're working on, send those to awesomehardwarerules@gmail.com. Kyle's got that email set up. He's already gone through and picked out a good four or five. We're kind of browsing them, and we are getting much closer to picking one.
Yes.
There's some really good options, though, so thanks to you guys who have sent them, and please feel free to continue to do so. Speaking of Awesome Hardware logos, you can now buy a hoodie.
We're selling Awesome Hardware merch now?
Yeah, with an Awesome Hardware logo on it.
I didn't even know that.
I'm going to show you guys Kyle's site because I'm...
It's on my site?
I'm magnanimous like that.
Well, our t-shirt guy is good.
Yeah, look at that. This is Epic John. He already put that up here. So you can buy from either site, my site or Kyle's site. Doesn't matter. All the profits go to me. So this is the Awesome Hardware. Just the standard logo right there. Black hoodie. Straight up, good to go. So if anyone's interested in that, and then again, guys, we are working on a logo for that's not just our faces, something more. So if you want to buy other stuff on Kyle's site, why is your site loading so slowly, Kyle? Oh, it's because I'm on your site, not your store.
Right.
Anyway,
gotta load videos.
You have other stuff on your store? What else is going on in your store?
Pretty much. Oh, the same deal that that you had. Did you already mention the 50% thing?
No.
Okay, so, or not 50%. If you guys spend $50 or more on either of our sites, you actually get a 10% discount. Keep in mind, the hoodie's already $42, so if you get a hoodie plus a t-shirt and you use the coupon over 50, I think you get a 10%, you get a 10% discount. So
if you spend more than $50, over 50 is the code you can use, and you get 10% off of your order. So buy $50 worth of stuff. Also on my site, I have, not only do I have the Awesome Hardware black hooded sweatshirt, as you can probably see here, although it's small. I also have my new logo on some things. So on a simple hoodie design here, also black hoodie, just nice. Like the Awesome Hardware.
Not
that I'm competing with our Awesome Hardware sweatshirts or anything, but I am. and then That's okay. I also have a gift set. You can get a hoodie and a couple mugs. kind of gift set. And then I also have just standard t-shirts.
And put hot chocolate in the mugs.
Yeah, and this
chances are you'll be cold if you're buying a sweater.
Yeah, so. That's why mugs are great for this time of year. Anyway, this is my updated logo.
Nice.
So I was phasing out the old logos, and I am still phasing out. I'm running really low on inventory as far as the old stuff goes.
Did this new logo inform you that the shape of your head is very similar to that of a thumbscrew?
Yeah, that's really where the original thumbscrew design
came from. You should overlap those two images and just have like a Paul's head thumbscrew. That should be like your like a future logo. I think that'd be cool.
We could work on that.
Yeah.
Send those thumbscrew logo Paul's head ideas to
do it.
Kyle's email address. But let me just, I gotta finish up with my story here. I also have this ongoing sale right now because I'm, like I said, I'm trying to clear out some old inventory. So I have some $12 shirts in the old logo. These are, once they're gone, they're gone. There's only a few left of those. I also have some $25 hoodies. And there's only like, I think like two or three of each of those left as well.
Nice.
Limited sizes and everything. So check those all out. And I think that is.
Two more things I want to mention about this. This applies to both of our stores. If you guys happen to buy anything, you will get it before Christmas if you buy like today or this week. But our t-shirt guy that we go through, he does one day shipping. So if you're thinking about getting this as a gift or you just want to have it for in time for Christmas, you will be getting it before then. So important to note that.
Yeah, it's still a good week to 10 days-ish that you can order.
Not to mention we will be doing loud and proud Johnson shout-outs at the end of each half of the show. For anyone who happens to buy a piece of merchandise from either of our stores during the show, we will give you a nice loud and proud Johnson there. So
indeed,
keep that in mind.
Okay, I think that is all for the announcements.
Those are all the
we had lots of them. Sorry, there were so many announcements at the beginning of the show.
Yep.
Let's move on to our first segment, which does not have a title. What?
Aren't you forgetting something, Paul?
Oh, I forgot beer.
How could you forget beer?
I almost forgot the beer.
We never forget beer.
I almost forgot the beer.
So I picked these up from the local. What are they called? Liquor stores. One of the local liquor stores that I like
fishmonger?
To frequent. They have a lot of good craft beer there. You got an opener. Yes, One Stop Liquor. These are the guys who sponsored us long ago on one of those episodes. I paid full price for this, although they did hook me up with some other pretty cool, some cool items earlier. But what I'm drinking right now is a Modern Times Monsters Park Stout.
Oh.
I've never had this before. I've had Modern Times before. They're known for like really good cheap Pilsner six packs, which I was blown away when the guy recommended this to me at the store because I was like, Modern Times, aren't they like kind of cheap? And he's like, no, this is like one of the best Imperial Stouts we have on hand. So cheers to that. Hopefully it's good.
All right. I, meanwhile, have a Bootleggers Brewery Mint Chocolate Porter.
I picked that out for you
mint
because...
Mint and chocolate.
A, it's very festive, and B...
Red and green on the logo.
And B, I wanted to try it myself, so I was like, if I get Paul...
Ale brewed with mint, 6.1% alcohol, so I probably won't be quite as wasted as I was for last week's show.
Not a bad thing. Although on Awesome Hardware, it's always a bad thing.
Yours is 12%. Kyle might be.
Jesus,
that's
good. I did not... Hey, this beer is vegan.
It is.
That's what it says.
Okay.
All right.
Didn't know that was a thing.
Modern times.
Vegan beer.
All right. Cheers.
Yay. Start the show. Cheers to all you guys. Mm-hmm. Oh, that's minty.
Mm.
It is. It's minty and chocolatey.
Yep.
For sure. Yeah, give it a shot whenever you...
Here, try this.
Oh, we're sharing,
it's
we're
like
sharing
we're, it's
juices
like we're
right now. Oh,
like
yeah.
Kissing.
I'm drinking out of this lovely Paul's Hardware Imperial Pint glass. Sorry. Product placement. Mm.
That's actually really good. I like that.
Mm-hmm.
Makes me want
to
stock some...
I can taste the extra...
Stuff some stocking stuffers.
I can taste the extra power in yours.
I can taste the vegan.
And then the veganness.
Vegan powers.
All right. Was my mouse not working? It's because I have two mice and only one of them works for each thing. All right, first segment. That's what I was going to say. I don't have a title for this segment because it's a one-off segment because it's all news about a specific thing that happened this week, but let's just click on something.
Okay.
Let's click on Pimp My PC.
Pimp My PC?
Yay, Pimp My PC.
No. Why are we on Pimp My PC?
We will be doing Pimp My PC on Kyle's Half of the Show. Stay tuned. If you're watching in the future, it's on Kyle's Half of the Show.
Are you just testing it right now?
No, I'm just throwing something up there to throw something up there. All right. we're going to be talking about the AMD... it's not AMD, though. It's Radeon Technologies Group.
Right.
A subsidiary or a subgroup or a
the rebel force
like
AMD.
A number of employees at an AMD that have been chastised and forced out away from everyone else.
The resistance!
Radeon Technologies Group has been formed, I don't know when... recently this year.
1 million years.
It's meant to be all about the graphics cards from AMD. So AMD, who first bought ATI, brought them in, fused and merged them with AMD until they were like, we don't even need ATI anymore, we'll leave that behind. And now they've, I feel like they've, ATI has passed through AMD and has, wait, no, that doesn't, that sounds bad, because it's coming out the other end.
Permeated.
Yes. And now AMD has created this Radeon Technologies group. It's supposed to be all about the graphics cards, and they had an event. Just when? When did they have this event?
Earlier.
It was in Sonoma.
In the past.
It was in Sonoma, California, which always sounds like a really...
Sonoma.
I feel like if you went to Sonoma, it would be all wineries.
Sonoma Valley.
And, like, nice... Like. But is that even right? I don't
Sonoma
even know if
vineyards.
That's right. I don't even know.
Yeah, it is.
It is?
It
okay.
is wine. Right. Wine
so family. Sonoma, fancy pants wine country, and AMD invited some people up there, including, I don't know if Ryan Shrout went. Yeah, I think Ryan Shrout went. So PC Perspective was there. And they have some information that they released about their upcoming technology for 2016, a lot of the stuff they've been working on. It's some pretty exciting information. So we're going to go over that in a few different segments. But first off, some shocking news that just came out this week, which was that Scott Wasson, our good friend
at Tech Report,
from the Tech Report,
right,
has been brainwashed by AMD and forced to join them.
No.
Yes, they did some Clockwork Orange style stuff with him. You know, had his eyes peered open with like AMD is good stuff flashing there for him.
It's horrible.
Scott Wasson, eventually, though, his mind broke under the onslaught.
Look, you can see the dead stare in his eyes. He's clearly not in control of his own psyche.
It's just a picture of Scott. It's,
oh.
The dead stare is...
Oh, never mind.
No, that's... Anyway. So we're reading the story from Anantech, although there were stories everywhere. There's Scott Wasson. Hey, who's that behind Scott Wasson right there? In
that's
that
you.
That's me.
What are you doing there? Famous.
That was in Hawaii, I think.
I think I was with you.
Yeah, I think that was in Hawaii. Anyway.
I'm probably drinking right behind your head.
And apparently, I just happened to be in the background in like Scott's happiest picture ever taken, because he was like, dude, Paul's right there. No, actually, at the AMD event, I was sat at the table with Anand and Scott.
That's right. We were both there.
Yeah, and I was like, I was too nervous to talk to either of them the whole time. And since then, I've talked to Scott.
And they are hardcore. When they're at a press event, they are like noses in their notebooks, just typing furiously.
Working, posting information online for people to read.
It's like, man, that article you just farted out got more views than I get in a month. It's pretty awesome.
Anyway, all right, so... All that stuff I said about him being brainwashed is not true. I made that up just for clarification here.
Jesus.
But Scott has gone over to join AMD, which I think a lot of people were surprised at when it was announced earlier this week. Scott, just so you guys know, founded the Tech Report back in 1999. Hugely respected, very popular website that covers tech news and stuff, the type of stuff you're into if you watch our show. He's retiring from that site at the start of next year, so being of 2016, and he's going to be joining AMD. He has worked, his work includes GPU frame pacing stuff that he did. I also went kayaking with him on the Chicago River a few months back. I wanted to list among his accomplishments.
Then he got to kayak with me.
Yeah, we went kayaking. No, but it's Tech Report's a great site, so it's this. There's two sides of this. One is like, man, it sucks for Tech Report to lose Scott. The other side of it is like, well, so Scott's a fabulous advocate for lots of stuff in the PC world, not just when it comes to gaming, but other stuff as well. Scott is the one who often says stuff like, we don't need more pixels, we need better pixels. He's said that many, many times. So we're hoping him going over to AMD has a very strong positive influence coming from someone from the enthusiast side and also holding them to task for stuff, because that's what he did when he was a reporter at Tech Report. He was like, hey, your drivers aren't doing this right. We have evidence here that we've worked out to show that, and he can, you know.
And a lot of us are AMD users anyway, so we're still going to be benefiting from whatever work he does there.
Yes.
And this isn't like the when Anand went to Apple.
Yeah,
it's like, oh, that, well, that does nothing for me.
You just brought up such a
too soon.
Yeah,
too soon.
Yeah. The pain is still too near.
It is.
Anyway, though, Tech Report will go on. Managing editor and right hand man Jeff Kampman is going to be taken over the site for Scott. Scott is going to be sequestered in an AMD cave in Canada or Texas.
I bet he only drank red wine in Sonoma.
Drinking. God damn it, guys. Red.
I used to like white. They don't let me drink white wine anymore.
They don't have blue or green wine, so.
I know. Screw that green wine.
Anyway. All right, let's get on to some more. I'm pressing the wrong keyboard here.
Actually, that's white wine. Made from green grapes.
Some more stuff from this event in Sonoma, though. This, just to be clear here, this is something I think spawned from this event and information that was leaked out through it. This is not directly from this event, but this is some rumors that have come out. This was posted 5 days ago. This is a rumor from WCCF Tech about AMD's AM4 motherboards possibly launching much sooner than many people were expecting, as soon as March 2016.
Nice.
Configured for Bristol Ridge APUs.
Okay.
So just to be clear, the AM4 motherboards will support Zen FX processors.
Right.
But if these AMD motherboards launch at this time, or as early as they're saying they might, March 2016, they're probably not going to launch alongside Zen CPUs.
Right.
At least according to these rumors.
That's still
that
further
we're
out,
about.
I think.
Yeah, the Zen Q3. CPUs are still, they're still looking at later in the year, Q3 or probably Q4 actually, I think.
Yeah.
So bear that in mind. But if the motherboards launch, they're going to have something to go along with them. So they're probably going to be the APUs, the Bristol Ridge APUs that might launch alongside those. The FX series family that we're all looking forward to, because that's the Zen stuff,
yeah.
Is codenamed. Oh, I'm pressing wrong buttons again. Codenamed our little monitor screen is so tiny, so it's hard to see what's. Anyway. Yeah. So Summit Ridge is supposed to be the FX series. That's what Zen is, and
okay.
That's what we're looking forward to. And so they're going to have A-series APUs for mobile. They're also going to have A-series desktop APUs there, and then they're going to have the Zen, which will be their kind of cream of the crop up at the top stuff. And then that's really about all to say here. I'll show you guys this chart. This is all over on WCCF Tech if you guys want to check it out again. But they have sort of listed their theoretical specs side by side here. So 14 nanometer is the process node that Summit Ridge or Zen is supposed to be built upon. 8 CPU cores, no GPU included, so that's kind of interesting. They're still going kind of the Intel enthusiast route,
right.
Or so we believe, and not including an iGPU in their FX series. 95 watt TDP, and on die Northbridge, which is nice. No more two chipset boards for AMD. We'll just have
right.
A single chipset. And then launch here again, second half of 2016 is when they're potentially expecting that. Compared to Bristol Ridge, and this is why the big difference here, 28 nanometers. So this is using their existing Carrizo architecture, I believe.
Right.
Chorizo.
Someone make a meme of that.
Already getting
AMD Chorizo.
The AMD Chorizo.
Ooh. I'm sorry, I'm all over the place today.
Flavor from south of the border.
But you know what's kind of interesting about Bristol Ridge is that it's going to be introducing DDR4, so I'm curious to see what kind of effect that has on an APU performance.
It's a very good question.
So, you know, it's heavily dependent on DDR3 in the past. Now we get to see what it does for DDR4.
Yeah, so it'd be nice to see. I mean, APUs, system on a chip, I mean, whatever you want to call them. They're gaining hugely in popularity. It'd be cool, I think, to be able to build like a $250-ish like AMD APU system that actually has pretty decent graphics with like some DDR4 memory in there or something.
Yeah.
Making the hardware accessible and all that stuff.
Revance Diggs suggested an AMD Risotto, I think.
Oh,
I think
AMD Risotto.
Instead of Tropical Islands, AMD should just start basing all their CPU, future CPUs, off of pastas. the AMD Risotto.
It would make about as much sense as Intel's naming scheme.
Right?
I mean,
I don't see why not.
Intel's naming scheme, in case any of you are wondering, the criteria is you have to be able to point at it on a map.
If it's not on Earth, it doesn't exist.
Like, literally, all the stuff, all the names that you see from Intel stuff, like Skylake and, mm-hmm. and Kaby Lake and all of those things,
well.
They're all just things on a map. But not necessarily like a city or anything. It's just anything on a map.
It could be Los Angeles.
Yeah, they should do that.
The Core
I-7
Los Angeles.
I wonder if they'd run into, like...
No one would buy that.
Like... licensing claims or something if they did use a location like Las Vegas, the new AMD Las Vegas processor, or
right.
Intel Las Vegas.
Well, Intermax does that with their Vegas fans.
That's true.
So I wonder if they had any hoops to jump through for getting that license.
I don't know. I don't know. I know there's probably... I have no idea how the legalities of this type of thing work.
Right.
But I know a place like Las Vegas...
Right.
They're very much into their branding. They do Las Vegas ads and everything. You know, they have a Las Vegas ad council. So I could see them, you know, trying
to... Don't worry, guys. Paul and I have the hookups at Intel. Core i7 Vegas coming soon.
The i7 Vegas?
We'll put in a good word.
Sexy. All right. one more little story in this grouping here. And this one's pretty interesting. This is also from the Radeon Graphics Group. They're pushing forward with FreeSync, and they're expanding it to work over HDMI, also to work with mobile. Also, they're enhancing their DisplayPort, their use of DisplayPort with GPUs coming out this next year. And they're also adding HDR, which is something that I hadn't really heard too much about when it comes to monitors. Monitor handling HDR. HDR is something that you might see
your
your phone can do.
Right.
Anyway, though.
What am I saying? All phones are camera phones nowadays. Smartphone.
This is a PC World report by Gordon Ung, the inimitable. He's pointing out, for example, that what AMD's really going for here is more market adoption.
Right.
So adding HDMI FreeSync support will greatly enhance the number of the ability to connect to it and use it.
Right.
Because HDMI is a lot more prevalent than DisplayPort. And they're comparing here the number of display partners that AMD works with as compared to NVIDIA, the number of displays announced, which is 32, as compared to NVIDIA's 17. Quantity versus quality, right? I think would probably be NVIDIA's response to that. But all in all, I think all of us are very supportive of anything that's competitive because all of us want variable refresh rate. Once you've used it, you realize, yes, this is a thing and I want it for the future.
It's hard to go back.
It's not like 3D. You try something 3D and you're like, oh, that was kind of interesting for me to try out. Variable refresh rate, you're like, this is all I
need this in my life.
I will not play games anymore without
injected
this.
Injected in my veins.
So, yeah, making that more available is very important. And if this does that, then I'm all for it. AMD's also has a history of kind of championing the broad standards that lots of people have access to. Anyway, they are saying that they will be bringing FreeSync FreeSync via HDMI in 2016. Again, this could be a huge gain for adoption rates of FreeSync displays, but it is contrasted by the current install base of NVIDIA GPUs, which is over 80% when you compare the gaming market, specifically discrete graphics cards.
Wow.
NVIDIA has over 80% market share, so that is definitely probably the biggest hurdle to overcome from AMD's side. This extension could be used with both HDMI 1.4 as well as 2.0, so that's kind of nice, a little bit of backwards compatibility there. I mean, you're looking at the monitor side, though. So you're saying the monitor would have to support FreeSync, but if your graphics card only had HDMI 1.4, so maybe some older GCN architecture, AMD GPUs, could plug into a newer AMD FreeSync monitor with HDMI and work.
Huh.
Yeah.
Very nice, actually.
And then they've also announced in here the first mobile FreeSync device. So this is, again, a bit behind the game when you compare it to NVIDIA's current
G-Sync
range of G-Sync
laptops.
Mm-hmm. But it's definitely nice to see AMD pushing into this space as well. Lenovo has a 15.6-inch Y700 gaming laptop that they're launching. I don't think they had a date on here, but it's going to be $900. It's going to feature a Radeon R9 M380 GPU and a quad-core AMD FX 8800P Carrizo APU. Again, $900 for FreeSync-enabled.
That's pretty cheap.
15.6-inch gaming laptop. So honestly, that's small on the screen size for me. But I mean, I don't really game on laptops anyway. So,
well, anytime somebody's like, it's as big as it gets for a laptop, pretty much.
Yeah,
but I mean,
true.
Yeah, I get what you're saying. For a desktop, 15 inches. There's no 15 inch monitor.
I'm still so like gaming on a laptop is still something I do so seldom.
Dude, this gaming on this, I played GTA on this for like an hour yesterday. During my review. This is a new laptop, by the way. MSI GS60 Ghost Pro. It's amazing, and I'm doing a video on it. It's coming up really soon, probably going to launch this week, but stay tuned for that. It's the best gaming laptop I've used.
What is the graphics card in there?
970M.
Okay. It's pretty good.
Yeah, and Core i7 Skylake, so.
Nice.
Solid. Solid.
Looking forward to the review, Kyle. Okay. All right. Here's another cool thing. All right, HDR, high dynamic resolution, something. If you guys take pictures with your phone camera can probably do that. Most newer phones can do that with their camera. It's basically taking the light areas and darker areas of any given image and sort of lightening the dark areas, darkening the light areas so that everything's more evenly exposed. so that you don't take, so you don't have something where like something's really bright and something's really dark and you can't see either thing. Very, this is like the quickest, simplest explanation of HDR. Here, look, HDR. Look, there's a picture of it. It's a very small picture. Make it bigger.
Till it's all
pixelated. There's HDR. See the one on the left, no HDR. One on the right, HDR.
Clearly, HDR is better, Paul.
HDR is better.
I can
better.
See the difference.
It's been empirically proven by this imager. DisplayPort 1.3, though. This was this kind of little hidden gem tucked into the story that I was kind of excited about. AMD is supporting DisplayPort 1.3 and GPUs launching next year. DisplayPort 1.2, despite having massive amounts of bandwidth and being like the god of display connection standards for quite some time, doesn't have enough bandwidth to do like 4K 60 hertz or other fun resolutions. So DisplayPort 1.3, 1920 by 1080 gives you up to 240 hertz at standard definition or using HDR. So notice that they've also included HDR numbers here, which means that the monitor has to, I believe, sample different images. I'm guessing here. Sample different images, so it takes. There's a little bit of processing time involved, so you can't get quite as fast of a refresh rate. Right. Anyway, 2560 by 1440 up to 240 hertz, 170 with HDR, 3440 by 1440, a resolution I've been very fond of recently, up to 190 hertz or 144 HDR, 4K 120 hertz or 60 hertz HDR,
nice,
and 5K up to 60 hertz. I'm looking forward to that, DisplayPort 1.3. It's a good reason to give yourself.
Of course, you'll need
more.
A DisplayPort 1.3 port on your monitor.
You'll need it on your monitor, and you'll need it,
and on
the video card itself.
Right.
All
right,
let's move on to the next segment. How are we doing on time? Oh wow, we're doing pretty fast. No, we're not moving very fast.
we're very slow.
Let's move on to Swordfight. It's time for Swordfight.
All right,
Kyle and I are going to argue some stuff. We're going to ask you guys to also join in the arguments, if you so desire. And my sword fight questions were put together a little hastily.
I thought this was pretty interesting. I managed to peek at it just for a brief moment.
You looked at this article?
The first one, and I thought it was kind of interesting, but I didn't get the chance to read through it all. What is it about?
So here's an article that I randomly came across. This was, who posted this on Twitter? It wasn't Will Smith. It was one of his friends.
Jada. It was Jada Pinkett Smith, wasn't it?
Not that Will Smith. The Will Smith
his
who
kid,
actual...
The Karate Kid? The new Karate Kid?
No, Will Smith, who used to write for Maximum PC, and
Big
he did
Willie.
Tested, and he's done a lot of stuff. You don't know who he is. That's fine.
Oh.
But he has the Twitter handle Will Smith.
Oh.
Because he...
Damn.
Was more...
That's pretty boss.
Yes.
He trumped the actual Will Smith.
Because he's in tech, and he was like, Twitter, he was like a lot faster than I was. I don't even have Paul's hardware, I have Paul hardware.
Did you notice, by the way, that Paul Ace, they changed their Twitter handle?
What? To Paul's Ace Hardware?
Paul's Hardware is now Paul's Ace Hardware.
Oh, really?
Yeah. They changed it because...
Oh, there's just a name on there. Were they getting...
But the handle, I think, as well.
You can't... No, you can't.
You can change your handle.
You can change it? But you have to, like, register a name, and then you can have Twitter move your account over to that name.
Right.
But Paul's Ace Hardware is too long, because I tried to register that name for them so that I could say, here, use this, and give me Paul's Hardware.
Interesting.
Which didn't work out.
Interesting.
Well, I didn't even have the name to trade.
I'm going to look it up right now, because I could have sworn they
you,
actually
you could.
Changed All right,
we're getting
things.
Slightly off topic here.
Back, no, we're not.
Back to the point.
Totally
which
on
is
topic.
The linguistics of the YouTube voice. Interesting little article over here in the Atlantic. And this is basically the Julie Beck, who wrote this article, was watching YouTube videos. What it was.
You're right.
I'm right. Okay. and she was interested in how people on YouTube talk, how they speak, and the inflections they use, and how certain people who can do a whole video, and I've come across this too, and I've had the thought to myself, you know, somebody who sits there for 5 to 10 minutes. With the camera on them, you know, just a standard shot, and talks for 5 minutes or 10 minutes or whatever.
Right.
And they don't cut to anything. They don't edit. They're lazy and stupid. No, they're able to sit there and talk for a certain period
Wait,
of time.
They're talking about YouTubers that don't cut at all in their videos?
She's talking about a manner of speaking.
Okay.
She's talking about a certain way of using inflection, a certain way of enunciating, a certain way of elongating vowels.
Penis.
To emphasize certain specific words.
Vaginal.
Vagina.
vaginer.
Why are we saying... Why?
I don't know.
All right. Point being...
Because we clearly know how to talk to an audience.
Point... Overstressed about... So she took this... First, it was just something that occurred to her, and then she actually went to a linguistics person, and they talked about certain things like overstressing vowels.
Yep.
Not using the noise, the schwa, or so it's called. Louis C.K. talks about this when he talks about like listening to people talk and just the kind of word vomit that slips out of people's mouths.
Right.
Like, eh.
Yeah.
That's an awesome bit.
When he does this like semi-gay voice. Yeah.
It's awesome.
It is.
We should just watch Louis C.K.
We should.
Anyway, point being, what was my point? Yeah, so she's talking about this, and I was reading this because I do YouTube videos, and I was like, I don't feel like I've ever...
You don't say.
Beyond some thought I've given to, like, all right, I need to, like, not rush through a sentence and say it so quickly that people can't understand me.
Right.
I need to do some level of, like, vocal exercises or that kind of thing. I don't know. I need to make sure people can understand what the hell I'm talking about.
Sure.
But using these other methods she's talking about to, like... engage the audience more or make things more interesting or that kind of thing. She talks about like moving around on camera and flailing your arms around, and you wouldn't know anything about that.
Did you see Cell's comment?
No.
He just said Kyle does that by flailing his arms around like someone having a stroke.
Exactly. Exactly. All right.
That was for yourself.
Let's actually do this. Posted that in chat.
Hey, it's working.
Here's a straw poll.
People love the stroke.
So here's my question for you guys. Is this deceptive? Should we, as people presenting on camera to you, should we try to, like, make our voices sound more appealing? Or should we just talk the way we normally talk? With the cuss words and the... You're dusting off your laptop.
Yep.
All that good stuff. Is this deceptive? Or is this... are we trying to manipulate you as the viewer by doing this? Do you do this? That was going to be my first one. Do you...
Well,
have you ever thought about this type of thing?
Yes, I have. And
okay.
I tend to, well, since I script out all my videos, at least for the reviews and whatnot, I tend to have this, like, review tone, or some people call it, like, a newscaster or a news announcer tone, where
yes.
I'm, like, very proper.
And that's exactly what the article's talking about.
But I feel like that is just a hyper-extended version of my personality, where it's like, that's literally how I'm feeling, and that's my genuine energy, but I'm just translating it into the form that they see on camera. And you can even like go so far as to say this is very similar to like the Colbert Show,
yeah.
Right? Stephen Colbert, he's not always that up and peppy if you were to meet him in person. I'm sure of it. But for the camera and for the show and for what the show entails, he kind of has that hyper-extended version of himself that he portrays, and people get it. They understand that this isn't really who he is, but he's kind of putting on a show, and people are okay with that. I don't think it's false advertising or anything. As long as you're not saying this is how I am ordinarily, you know, normally, then I don't really see a problem with it. And if people are cool with it, and if it creates kind of a style on its own, then that's kind of part of your brand, I guess, whatever you want to call it. That does become an extension of your own personality, and I don't know.
Okay.
Yeah. I guess I just did. I just argue.
You kind of just did. I was gonna say. I was gonna say.
Didn't even realize.
For the sake of brevity.
Yeah.
And since Kyle already kind of argued one of these points, let's just go with that because it was a good argument, and I'll take the opposite side. So Kyle's arguing, yes, it's okay. It helps people understand. It creates. You even added more to that. It creates a brand. It creates a certain mannerisms that people might come back to you for. I mean, there's good examples of that. But I should stop arguing your side and say, no, it's fake and lame, and you should use your normal voice, you douchebag. I put douchebag in there. And then the third answer is it's just a simple question. I don't see why name calling is necessary. But any of you guys can answer any of those if you want to. So, here's my counter to that. YouTube has seen a meteoric rise in popularity in a lot of different cases, and not just in genres like ours, but lots of different genres across the internet. And you've seen lots of people who have been fortunate enough to find audiences who have gone from relative obscurity to having millions of subscribers and doing it for their regular job, and you know, and that, I think that's kind of great. But I think there's a reason why people have gone to view a lot of these people, and that is because of a certain level of of genuineness. Right. Genuinativity. Because they are genuine.
Genuinivity.
Because they are more transparent. Because you're not looking at someone who went to communications school and spent however many months in elocution lessons, and who's trying to present something that they think you'll like. You're just watching somebody who's like, I'm making a video, and here's me making a video.
Right.
And it's straightforward. Yep. So I think modern audiences don't necessarily want to see that sort of that polish, that sort of like pizzazz, that extra little slathering of like fake peppiness
right.
going on top of things
right.
to get you into it. People just want the raw deal.
They just love you for you.
Okay. All right, let's see what you guys think about this one. Results.
Just be yourself, guys.
Results.
Just be yourself.
All right. Here it is. Most people say it's okay. Pretty much. Yeah, lots of people say it's okay. It helps understand what's being said. People say it's fake. And 39 people were offended that I said douchebag. Yeah, I think what it comes down to here, and I would probably agree with Kyle on this one, is that I do the same thing. I definitely found myself in a video where it's like, all right, I'm going to sit and point the camera at myself and just talk. I talk a certain way, and I like, I spend more time doing things. When I have a script, like, I don't have to focus on what I'm saying. I already know what I'm going to say. I can focus a lot more on how I'm saying it.
Right.
So... yeah, I definitely do the same. I definitely have here's my scripted announcer voice or whatever, right. and here's my, like, just casual voice.
And that's kind of what I try to do with my channel as well, is, like, I do have the very scripted reviews that are very, cut and dry. It's, like, exactly what I want to say. It's very concise, and it does have that kind of peppy, tone to it. But at the same time, I don't want that to be all the channel is. And so I often throw in vlogs or like handheld style builds where I'm just like, hey guys, it's just me and you, because I want them to know this is what I'm really like. And they should know by watching, if you're an avid viewer of my channel, you know what I'm really like versus when I'm doing a review.
Yep.
And I think a lot of the time it's important to have both. If you are going to be a presenter, for example, and you do want that hyper extension of yourself, to really let your audience know who you are, when all the pizzazz and all the sizzle is gone, because I think that is, like you said, what makes a lot of these YouTubers really, really successful in the, tens of millions of subscribers, is when they feel like they know you personally.
Yep.
And I think that's something that all the top tech tubers have also taken into account, clearly, because they're all doing it right as well. So, yeah.
Yep. And I've always admired your ability to maintain that facade. Okay, let's move on to the next.
I will drink all of your beer and feel bad about it.
Next question. I don't have an article to go along with this question, because this one we already kind of discussed as I went over all that AMD stuff. AMD's seen its fair share of hard times over the past, 7 years. they've really kind of been on a what seems like to some degree a downward spiral. When it comes to, just the how long it's been since they launched a new CPU microarchitecture.
Because you got to think, they're getting rammed from both sides. They're getting, like, double-fisted from NVIDIA and Intel.
Exactly.
Like, they have a big task to carry on their shoulders, so
but
I get it.
But for those of us who, one, like competition, and two, maybe like to pull for the underdog, or three, maybe you like AMD. People
right.
like AMD. It's fine to like a... to like a company, for whatever reason. There's right. also people who really don't like AMD. Darth Beavis. but that's not the point. The point here is, will 2016 be AMD's comeback year? We've heard a lot of stuff recently, them talking about stuff they have coming down the pipeline. There's a lot of hype behind Zen. I think a lot of us really hope it lives up to expectations. They got the HBM stuff. They had kind of a head start with HBM with the Fury launch.
Right.
We're looking at HBM2 stuff coming next year, so it's really exciting. But how much do you believe the hype? Are you looking at this like AMD? Yeah, sure, they're talking this stuff, but 2016 is going to come and go, and at the end of it, we're going to be like, man, I really hope AMD can claw themselves out of this still, or like, wow, right. they're still hanging around. But I don't know. So, what are you guys' feelings on this? Do you think AMD is kind of poised for a comeback? Or the opposite. Kyle, which side?
I answered the first one, so you go this time.
All right.
You win this one.
I'm going to just... I'm going to be contrary to myself and go with the opposite of what my initial thought was. So I'm going to take the negative stance on this. I'm going to say no. And I'm going to say this because of the FX series relaunch. That's exactly why I put that in there. Because this is one of the things that I saw come and go in my time talking and discussing technology stuff. And FX series, right? I was working at Newegg in 2005, 2006 when the FX series originally launched. And this was when AMD, like, with gumption and I don't know, just, like, they did stuff that the people said was stupid and crazy, but it ended up being the right decision, and they blew Intel out of the water. Intel had to stage a comeback of their own, and they did a very good job with that with the Core series and leveraging their massive...
Budget
and all that kind of stuff. But AMD, they integrated a memory controller before anyone else. They did multi-core processors, dual-core processors. They had the first dual-core processor. The FX60, FX62 dual-core processors were amazing for their time. They were $1,000 processors. AMD tried to take that and that sort of feeling that people had going back to that at the time, being like, man, AMD's golden years or whatever in the CPU space. And they tried to, like, take that and slap it on the FX series and say, here's your FX series. And it was just stupid. Right. Like, it wasn't anything near what the FX series had been in the past as compared to what Intel was offering at the time.
Right.
It was a big letdown. And sure, you know, your FX series processors, they're fine, they work, but they're nowhere near the Intel processors when it comes to the core stuff, instructions per clock, all that kind of stuff. So I'm still,
right.
I'll admit, I'm still a little wary based on that and based on AMD talking up stuff because they've done it in the past. And, you know, I also, I'm the kind of person, I like to keep low expectations, and that way, hey, if everything does work out great, then I'll be pleasantly surprised rather than disappointed. Anyway.
I'm pretty much the same way as you, Paul, but for the sake of Swordfight, I'm not the same as you, Paul. I'm totally different and opposed to everything you just said. I think AMD is totally going to make a comeback this year.
Oh, yeah.
I think, you know, their decision to... Or their ability to keep Jim Keller on for that long to really kind of finalize and flesh out the rest of the engineering process for Zen is going to be worth it in the end. Because Jim Keller has done a lot of great things for AMD so far. Granted, he just jumped ship after making Zen, maybe that's a sign that he's like, oh, this is shit's going down the drain.
He's easily distracted.
He's easily distracted. That's all. Honestly, I'm going to be... I think positivity and optimism is what is really needed here in AMD's time of crisis. How much worse could it get for AMD, right? Well, I'm going to totally flip this, right? It can only go up from here, and I think this might be the crucial turning point that AMD really needs to be competitive once again with at least, maybe not with NVIDIA. I don't see them getting competitive with NVIDIA. But maybe with Intel.
I feel like they're a lot more competitive with NVIDIA right now than they are with Intel, to be honest.
Yeah, I guess you're right.
Yeah.
Maybe I just don't... I'm just lying through my teeth right now trying to argue for AMD.
Maybe you just got saddled with arguing the side that you...
Yeah, didn't. Yeah. Let's just see what you guys thought.
I tried to pick the no, so that I thought the positive thing was something you...
No, I was leaning towards nope.
No, all right, everyone's feeling
very...
Yeah,
you took mine.
Very dour about AMD. All
no,
right.
I just couldn't hang with it.
Everyone's like, I thought it was supposed to be 2015. I wasn't sure if I should put that one in there, but everyone's like, wasn't 2015 supposed to be the year that they came out with all this fancy stuff?
Another year.
But I don't know what to say. Apart from that, the hell yeah votes did strongly outweigh the no votes, so maybe there's all right. So I think what we can draw from this is that there's a certain level of reserved excitement, but it's very reserved. It's very like,
it's wishful thinking.
Yeah.
It's like not having the evidence or really the proof to back up what you want to happen or that you think it's going to happen, but you would just love to see it. I think the people that voted, like, yes, it's going to be their comeback year, are the people that just really want that to be the case.
Yeah.
As opposed to the people that can really see it and virtualize it in their heads. Like, yes, I can see the path. It makes sense to me. I don't think it makes any sense that, you know, AMD is going to come back that strong next year. But I think it's just a thing that every techie wants to see, or at least most of us, we want to see more competition between Intel, AMD, and NVIDIA. And so we're all rooting for AMD, even though they really are the underdog in this point. And
yep,
we'll have to see.
I feel there. All right.
You feel me?
Let's move on.
All right.
Let's move on to the next segment.
What do we got?
Next segment.
Come on.
It's Hot and Heavy Hardware.
Hey.
Time for Hot and Heavy Hardware. We're going to talk about some hardware stuff. This is all stuff that's typically Hot and Heavy Hardware is stuff that's available now or very soon.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
That's kind of
more or less.
All right. And yeah, let's kick it off with this new Corsair cooler.
Oh yeah!
It's a low-profile liquid CPU cooler for small form factor setups. This one right here.
Oh yeah!
Remarkably similar to the one they use in the Bulldog.
I think it's compatible with.
Pretty
the Bulldog.
Sure it is the one they use in the Bulldog. Yes. So this is like a trickle down. They built the Bulldog. They saw a need for a specialty cooler in the Bulldog. They designed one for it, and now they're like, hey, let's just sell this by itself. Smart idea. So here it is on an ASUS Mini ITX board. You can see it's fairly large compared to the board itself, but that's a whole enclosed all-in-one liquid cooler.
Right.
So, there it is.
And is that the exhaust right there with the fin array right there?
Yeah, so the exhaust is right there, and that would kick out the back of the case.
So it doesn't go out both sides, it just goes out the back.
As far as I know, it only exhausts out the back right there, because it has a blower style fan.
Okay, right. Right above the water block thing.
This is the Hydro Series H5SF. SF, small form factor? Small?
Oh, SF, yeah, small.
Super.
Small form.
Small
form.
I don't know. It's 84 millimeters tall, so significantly shorter than any tower-style coolers that are out there.
Right.
150 watts of heat dissipation. It's got a 120 millimeter by 40 millimeter radiator.
Pretty fatty.
Yeah.
That's a good thickness.
That's the radiator on the back right here.
Yeah.
So this is a funny thing that I noticed looking at the design here. This little block right here is pretty much the radiator, 120 millimeters wide,
right,
and 40 millimeters tall, right? Or yeah, 120 by 40. And then this whole thing right in here, under the Corsair logo, is a blower-style fan.
Oh, okay.
So this is spinning here, and it's kicking stuff over the radiator, which is right here, which is fairly small. It's fairly small, but apparently with this design, they're still able to get 150 watts of heat dissipation, which is pretty good.
I think it's a smart choice to go with a smaller radiator and a more sizable fan than vice versa.
You're probably right. That probably keeps noise down.
Yeah.
I
like that.
Yeah, it's a 120 millimeter low noise blower fan. $80 MSRP, which is also fairly competitive. Yeah. And small form factor ITX boards with stuff like, you know, Skylake processors. I mean, you can get high-end overclockable processors on something like this. So I think $80 for this type of product is a pretty good offering. So good job, Corsair, and way to make use of those.
It looks like there's a decent
R&D
amount of
hours.
RAM clearance there too.
Yeah, it definitely
like
does. On the opposite
heat
side,
you'd be all right.
It's pretty high on this far end here. I'd be curious to see like this hose how far it goes back and like what it looks like on the underside there, that kind of thing. Be interesting, but
has Asetek sued them yet?
Asetek has not sued them, no. But we are gonna be discussing Asetek being all continuing to be all sue happy in just
good.
A moment.
Unless Asetek made half of that cooler.
Unless Asetek sues us for talking crap on them. Intel has readied a Skull Canyon product. Everyone's like, is it a super awesome motherboard? No, they don't make motherboards anymore.
Yeah, they stopped that, remember?
Nobody get excited about that. But look, there's the Skull Canyon logo.
Hey, SSD?
Very popular. No, it's a Nook.
Irish?
There's not even a picture of it here, so I just have to show you guys the Skull Canyon logo.
A new Nook?
A new Nook. The fastest Nook ever. A Nook with Irish Pro graphics that apparently is fast enough to warrant a Skull Canyon logo on it. I personally have fond memories of the Skull Canyon logo. I think it should be reserved for super awesome hardware.
And motherboards that aren't made anymore.
And motherboards that aren't made anymore. Well, I mean, that's where it first was the the Skull Trail motherboard, which is absolutely awesome. Yeah. So this is the most powerful Nook ever. Just like saying it's the fastest.
The fastest turtle.
The fastest turtle. No.
You've ever seen.
According to this article, it is, because it's not confirmed yet, it's likely using a sixth generation Skylake core processor, as well as Intel's Gen 9 Iris Pro 580 GPU, or GT4E, whatever that means. That would mean if it has that Iris Pro graphics built in, that gives it 72 execution units and 128 megabytes of EDRAM L4 cache, which I have a vague knowledge of what that means. The EDRAM has been useful as L4 cache. I'm going to leave it at that. I don't want to say anything more.
We'd have to test it out.
I risk really saying something really that's completely erroneous. But yeah, I don't know. Are you guys at all excited about like a high-end Nook? Would you game on a Nook? Have you been interested in stuff like the Gigabyte Brixes that they've been putting discrete graphics cards in? I don't know.
No.
Maybe. For a certain audience, it's okay. If for people like us, probably, who like to take our computers apart and put it back together for no apparent reason, Nooks, just they're just not as exciting, because it's like, oh, I could drop some memory in.
Right, maybe an SSD.
Yeah, maybe expand the storage. But beyond that, there's not a whole lot you can do. So yeah. Anyway. Yes, Joe Mama, thank you. Jumbo Shrimp Military Intelligence. He was trying to give us better examples of, like, the fastest Nook. Anyway. Skull Canyon Nook. All right, let's move on. One more hot and heavy here. Wait, no.
Hot and heavy!
No, that's all. Wait.
No,
wait.
We got one more.
Where'd the last one go?
Corsair.
It's Corsair.
At the bottom. It's on the next page.
I lost the story. I added that late, and so I never, I never clicked it. Never clicked it. All right. One more thing here. This is also a Corsair thing. The page loads up from PC perspective. Corsair, this was just sort of announced, and some reviews went out on it this morning. They have a 600 series inverted ATX chassis or enclosure that they've created. There's an image of it right there. So flipped motherboard, definitely something we've seen before in lots of other cases, but it's not as mainstream. Typically you see this on, I don't know, non-mainstream cases. I can't even pull up a case model out of my butt.
C600?
That has an inverted motherboard or a 90-degree rotated motherboard?
Well, you mean inverted. high-end case or...?
Just any case off the top of your head that has inverted...
TJ08 from Silverstone.
Oh, that's a good one. I bet there's going to be a lot of people in chat pulling that up. Hey, Fractal Josh is here. What's up, Josh?
What up, Joe?
All right, so 600C, which PC Perspective site is loading very slowly on that image. Here's a look at the side, though. This is the one with the windowed side panel. This is all open. So the it's got this little kind of... I watched Luke's, or some, I skipped quickly through Luke's video
right,
on this.
Yeah, I watched it this morning. Yeah.
He called this the attic, which is where the power supply goes up there. You can actually remove this entire plastic piece, which gives you a little bit more of a view of the power supply, but it's still kind of blocked by that one there.
Right.
It's an interesting chassis. It seems pretty well made, you know, as you would expect from the Corsair line. It's actually got a couple 5 1/4 inch bays at the
top. Doesn't it remind you of the S340 a bit, the NZXT case? Especially the feet. When you look at the feet. Just how minimalistic it is with the... It's just a monolith. Yeah. It's very monolithic, and it looks like the S340 a bit. Is that right? S340? Am I getting that right? S340.
That's what
I don't know. It reminds me of the S340 as far as like the form factor, the shape.
Okay, I get what you're saying.
And it's got a really big window.
It's like a upside-down S340.
Yes, basically. But I actually kind of like having it inverted. I like having a radiator at the bottom, blowing it out through the bottom. But yeah. I'm curious about like cooling for that bottom card if you were going to do SLI or crossfire, because there's no real top fans other than your power supply, you know, to direct.
Yeah, I mean, I think they're mainly just relying on those front intakes.
I'm wondering if there's like a fan up here, but that's like a 5 1/4 inch bay.
Yeah.
So,
it's definitely like. The inverted design definitely gives you a much better look at, like, GPU coolers, for example.
Right.
But they're all designed to be the other way around now. So, like, your text and everything is...
kind of weird.
...is pretty much always going to be upside down unless you customize it or something like that. So, yeah, I like that layout. It also means that your opening is on the opposite side of what it would typically be.
Mm-hmm.
So...
I love what Corsair is doing with their side panel windows. How it's just like a flat piece of glass all around, or not glass, but that's acrylic probably.
That actually reminded me very, very much of the 760T,
yeah.
Which I have one of right now.
Big fan of.
The clasp is a little bit different, but yeah, very similar just as far as the amount of visibility it gives into the case.
Right.
The way it opens, which I like, but not quite as much. I still, the 650 is still my favorite way a computer case could open.
The 650 from Corsair?
650 from Corsair, yeah. Because it had two clasps, the door would lift out, and then you could just pull it up and off. It's the same way that the 600T opens.
Right, 600T, I was going to say.
But I like the implementation of the 650 better. Mm. I just felt, it's the only case I felt like you could really easily pull the side panel off of. You didn't have to, like, force anything back on to get everything to line up, to get catches to catch and all that kind of thing.
Right.
And even if there's something, like, right next to the case in front of it, nothing had to swing out or anything like that. There was no door, which meant that with, like, the minimal clearance, as long as you didn't have anything above it, you could unhook it and just lift the side panel up and off.
Are you sure it was the 650?
Am I wrong?
That's not coming up.
650T, maybe?
I don't think that's the case.
Am I wrong?
You might be talking about the 700D or
No. Wait, hold on.
780T?
780T?
Is
that the 780T? Oh, I hope I'm not doing this. What? No, it's not the 780, it's an older one. 650
900D?
Wait, it was an Obsidian. Obsidian.
So, yeah,
650D. 650D, not T.
Okay.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
That's what I'm talking
about.
Yeah,
okay. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Which we can see and no one else can see because I'm not pulling it up here.
Yeah, screw them. Screw them all.
Here, I'll...
That was a good case.
650D.
The 900D's little brother.
The 650D suffered from being released prior to the finalization of the USB 3.0 header on motherboards. So it had a pass-through.
Right.
That was like the biggest thing. Your internet is gone right now. It's just, I can't load anything.
Really?
I don't know. I'm trying to search Google.
Mine's okay.
Oh, yours is stupid.
Awesome laptop.
Here.
Word.
Here's the there's the 650D right there. See? Two clasps.
Yep.
That's all. That's all that holds it on. You lift it off. It's and you're good. Anyway.
Yeah.
All right. I'm taking too much time. We need to move along. What is it? It's time for news. That's all for Hot and Heavy Hardware. Let's move on to news. Yay, news. Okay. We're starting off with the Asetek thing. Is Fractal Josh still in chat?
Yes, he is.
I bet he's... I don't know.
No, love to
I
pick can't. His brain about this I don't, I don't. Topic. Let's just put him on the spot. Put him on the spot!
Well, I know Fractal is affected by this because Fractal makes CPU coolers, all-in-one CPU coolers that Kelvin we have both used before.
Yes.
And they can't sell them in the U.S. Mm-hmm. because of this lawsuit. So mm-hmm. Asetek has now expanded... Well, they haven't expanded. They have found some more things that infringe upon their lawsuit for all-in-one cooling devices, specifically the AMD Radeon Fury X with the integrated water cooler.
Right.
As well as a Gigabyte, the WaterForce 980, the three-way water-cooled 980 that they came out with.
Right.
Apparently both of these infringe upon Asetek's patent. And so Asetek...
Of course they do.
...has sent them cease and desist letters. Now, as far as the Gigabyte side of it, I don't think they're going to care too much because, to be honest, the 980 WaterForce, not exactly an insanely popular product. I can't see them having any issue with just like, no, we won't sell that anymore. We weren't selling it anyway.
Yeah.
However, AMD's side of this is like that. We already discussed them being sort of embattled right now. That kind of sucks having to deal with yet another lawsuit.
Right. Way to go, Asetek.
The Fury X's cooler is actually made by Cooler Master. And in fact, if you take it off, as you can see.
Yeah.
In this image, it's got a Cooler Master logo on it.
Right.
Cooler Master was also, I don't know what the proper word is, indicted? No, implicated? Cooler Master. They lost
a lawsuit to
Asetek. Also went after Cooler Master, and Cooler Master lost.
Right.
So Cooler Master has already been ordered to give Asetek 25.375% of their revenue from all affected products since January 1st, 2015.
And that's up actually from 14% last year.
Oh, really? So they increased it more?
And actually it was funny because Cooler Master went to the judge to try to get it appealed or whatever and try to readjust the terms. And instead it backfired on them.
And the judge
ordered them to 25% from 14%. So they've been getting screwed.
I don't know.
It's unfortunate.
I think people should be able to patent their stuff, but...
But not abuse it to this extent.
This seems extensive.
Yeah.
Okay, so... PC Perspective, in this article, Scott Michaud, I'm sorry if I'm mispronouncing your last name, wrote this article. And he's speculating that Asetek was actually originally supposed to get the contract for AMD, because Asetek posted like an announcement, like a vague announcement at some point, saying that they received their largest ever design win with an undisclosed OEM.
Cooler Master said that?
Asetek said this.
Oh.
So that made Scott, who wrote this article, think, oh, Asetek thought they were going to get this contract with AMD to make the coolers for the Fury.
Right.
Or the Fury X. And then maybe the AMD changed their mind at the last minute or something with Cooler Master.
Yeah. But you taste that, Paul?
What?
Tastes a little bitter.
This is a little bitter?
Just a little bitter.
There's just some bitterness. Just seeps in there.
Is this by Asetek?
That you
Asetek Modern Times?
Asetek Day. Anyway. So this is pretty new. I'm very curious to see what AMD does about this. I don't know if they're going to... I don't know. Are they going to stop selling their flagship Fury X graphics card? No. They'll probably try to work out some sort of a profit sharing or something like that.
Yeah.
Anyway, a few other random stories here that I just wanted to pull up really quick. This one's about Dave Chappelle. I'm a big fan of Dave Chappelle's
comedy.
What's
up with Dave Chappelle these days? What's he up to? I'm a big Chappelle fan, too.
Dave Chappelle does stand-up comedy. He's keeping it pure.
Okay, so he's still doing stand-up.
Yeah, he goes around and he does stand-up.
Right.
He was out of the public eye for quite a while, but now he does stand-up comedy routines. To my knowledge, I mean, I don't know that I don't profess to be a huge Dave Chappelle fan and know exactly what he's doing at all times.
Sure, sure.
So I don't know if he's doing any other projects, but...
Call him on Twitter.
But people recording comedians is a pretty major problem for comedians. And this article also mentions how it's kind of a double-edged sword. If you're a lesser-known comedian and somebody records something you do that's funny and posts it and it goes viral, suddenly you can become famous very quickly.
Right.
However, for more well-known comedians who already have their fame established, it becomes a major problem for people bootlegging their material and posting it up on YouTube or other sharing sites and that kind of thing.
Right.
Dave Chappelle has 479,000 followers.
And his latest post says, "This account has been hacked. I'm deeming it officially bogus. Sincerely, Chappelle David K."
That's in March 2012.
That was in March.
He has not tweeted since 2012. Because he is so anti...
I'm not following.
So this is just a sort of an interesting means of preventing piracy at events, which is a company called Yonder, which is a startup in San Francisco.
Yonder.
And Dave Chappelle has entered into an agreement with them to provide audience members with these smartphone locking pouches at the shows. So you go into the show, you get this pouch. It comes in three sizes, so if you can't be like, my phone's too big to fit in the pouch. It comes in three sizes. You put your phone inside and lock it, and then you go into the venue. The venue, this probably uses Wi-Fi or something like that. The article is very light on the technology side of this, but it determines that you've gone into... Oh, did the YouTube stream drop? No, it says we're streaming to both.
We're good.
I don't know what's going on. Anyway, you go into the venue, and then suddenly the pouch locks, and you can't see your phone or do anything with it.
Interesting.
And if you want to use your phone, you walk out and use it in the lobby. Reasonable people should do anyway.
Brilliant, exactly. It's sad that it had to come to this to tell people to behave this way. But
so yes, it's kind of forced and everything, but I kind of like it because I'm the kind of person who I we all were sitting there for a second and you're bored, like, oh, something occurs to me, I'm gonna pull my phone out and look at it. Like, I really try not to do that when I'm at public, you know, something like a comedy show or something like that.
Right.
So I think this is a pretty cool idea for keeping people from doing that sort of thing. And I don't know, it popped up in my feed, so I decided to share it with you guys.
So is that an idea that he implemented himself?
He teamed up with the company. Oh, okay. So I'm sure the company already kind of had these things, and maybe they approached him somehow or something like that.
Every comedian should have them.
Yes. You can now delete games from your Steam library.
Oh, yeah.
Hey.
I heard about that.
You already had the ability to hide games from your Steam library. Now you can just flat out delete them.
Right.
I don't know which games you have played that you have in your library that you absolutely hate. But hey, maybe you got a game on that list. Maybe hiding was just not... Wasn't enough for you. Hiding, you still know it's there. Maybe your experience was just so bad that even the idea of it being there...
Some games should not be on your computer.
So yeah, now you can completely delete them to the point where if you wanted it back, you would have to go and rebuy the game.
Mm.
So just, yeah.
Really? Like, you'd have to rebuy it?
You would have to rebuy the game.
You couldn't just wipe it?
No. Because that's physically? Like not having a game installed. I'm not talking about delete a game from your system. People can do that all the time.
Right.
This deletes the game from your Steam account. I'll be honest, I have a few... I don't have a massive Steam account. I do not have a problem like Steve probably has where you always have to use lists or use a search tool or whatever just to find the game that you want to play. But I definitely have been involved in some betas and some trial stuff and that kind of thing that goes in and doesn't leave. Like, once it's there, I have some beta access things that I know that aren't even active anymore, but they're still on my list.
Yeah, that's true.
I could use this to maybe delete some of those, clear up the list.
Makes sense. Or maybe as a humble bundle, you got, like, 30 indie games for $5, and you're like, I'm not going to ever play, like, 15 of these. And you want to be able to delete those and free up some space on your hard drive or whatever.
Unfortunately, this says that bundled games you can't do it with.
Never mind. Sorry about that. I take everything I just said back.
But yeah, but you don't have to sacrifice a virgin to Steam customer support anymore in order to delete a game.
But I like sacrificing virgins.
I know. It's very disappointing. All right, one more story here for anyone who likes high-speed internet. Google Fiber. I like high-speed internet. Google Fiber is talking about deploying in Chicago and L.A., Aw, yeah. You know where I live.
What?
L.A. County.
My ninja.
You know where Kyle lives. Orange County. Guess you're SOL, bud.
What?
Yeah.
No, this is L.A. County.
It is? Oh, because it's La Mirada. See, I've lived my life. I grew up in La Habra.
Uh-huh.
Right on the very northern...
The cusp.
It's like the northeast, as northeast as you can go in Orange County without being in L.A. County.
Right.
So... You'd think I would know where the border is. All right, so Kyle and I are both in L.A. County.
Yeah, we're good.
Although
good,
this is talking about L.A., so it might be city.
Oh, fuck that.
I don't know.
Yeah, fuck that.
It's garbage. Anyway, you can see on the map here what current fiber cities there are, what's upcoming fiber cities there are, and the potential fiber cities, including Tampa, Jacksonville, Louisville, Chicago, Oklahoma City, Phoenix, San Diego, Irvine, Los Angeles, San Jose, and Portland.
Jacksonville.
Good old Jacksonville.
Jacksonville.
We need to hit up Johnsonville very soon here.
Yes, we do.
So yeah, that's just exciting because we need more broadband. We need more providers like Google who are shaking up the marketplace and giving us options and making ISPs not be stupid dickholes. Yep. These are the largest metropolitan areas Google Fiber is considered. 6 million plus people in them. There are 17 proposed metro areas for this service, which is $70 a month gigabit internet, in case you didn't know exactly what it costs. And then among those 17, Google has said it definitely will build in six.
Six of those, okay.
And that doesn't include, though, these two. So they're still, LA and Chicago are still on the fence. From Venice Beach to Wrigley Field, this is a quote, by the way, we'll study the different factors that would affect construction, like city infrastructure and topography, and use that information to help us prepare to build a local fiber network. While we can't guarantee that we'll be able to bring fiber to Chicago and LA, this is a big step for these cities and their leaders. Including me and Kyle.
Yeah.
I'm very excited about this. So I'm going to be meeting with Google's executives very soon.
We'll make it happen.
We'll make it happen. In the meantime, that kind of wraps it up for my half of the show.
All right.
But before we go... If you're watching this on YouTube in the future, the second half is over on Kyle's channel, which is Awesome Sauce News.
Yes.
Awesome Sauce Network, if you're, doing his real name.
Right.
I have a Johnson shout out for Raymond. Ray, thank you so much, sir, for helping us out and giving us support.
Oh, yeah.
And placing your order there. Kyle, got any Johnsons?
I have no Johnsons.
No Johnsons for
Everyone
Kyle.
Everyone hates me.
Everyone hates Kyle.
They're just like, fuck this, Kyle today.
This entire, but yeah.
Fuck you.
Ray got the, one of the good deals on the... Oh, no, he got the...
Did he get a hoodie?
He got one of my hooded pullover sweatshirts.
Discounted.
Bargain price, $25.
Steal!
Ray, I hope you don't mind calling you Ray. Mind me calling you Ray. I think you're really going to be happy with that.
What, you think you're friends?
All right.
Johnson!
Guys, what?
No.
Oh, we're just getting the Johnson. All right.
Johnson for the hoodie.
Lots of Johnsons. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for watching. Hit the like button if you're watching this on YouTube. Thank you all for joining us live if you have. Thanks to all the support from the folks in chat and our regulars. And we'll be right back with the second half in just a couple minutes. Are you going
to
pee?
I have to host the show now.
Kyle's going
to
pee, and then he's going to host the show.
Peeing.
All right. Bye. Goodbye, YouTube.
Bye.